was an authentic and very unusual service at the church. Just to give you an example, the ceremony ended with the church organ playing Fly Me to the Moon by Frank Sinatra. This song, Fly Me to the Moon, it mentions Jupiter and Mars, so it's an astrophysical theme. But in a way, this is a reflection on the fact that Stephen did not believe in God, and the family wanted to give it sort of an authentic feel. And his son spoke and about him as a father, and it was very moving to hear the son. And then there was a piece written by Socrates that Martin Rees read about why it's not so bad to die. Many of you probably know this argument, maybe many of the philosophers, that either you are in a permanent sleep mode, in which case, you know, at last you can sleep well, which is a great thing according to Socrates, or that you will meet all these distinguished scholars that you can chat with, and that's even better. And so the two options are both good, and therefore there is nothing to fear from. And I guess that was just before Socrates took the poison. We cannot ask him now if he was right. So that was
you
one.
You can ask him when you die.
Only the second one. Well, I suspect it's the first one, if I had to guess.
Oh, then you cannot ask him. Yeah, sorry.
But it's true that, for example, Epicurus, the Greek philosopher, argued that he has nothing to fear from regarding death, because as long as he is alive, death is not around, and vice versa. And therefore, he will never meet death, and therefore, there is nothing to fear from something he will never meet in person. So he wasn't worried about it. But otherwise, there were also some celebrities. There was the actor that played Hawking in the movie
Theory of Everything.
And also the actress that played Jane, his wife, she was there as well. And he read, the biblical text, There is a Time for Everything, which is true. I mean, I should say that text resonated much more with the truth than the Socrates text.
His gender, his first wife.
Sorry?
His first wife, Jane. She there?
Yes, she was there as well. The real person, but also the actress. and his family was all there. And then afterwards, there was some dinner where many of his students were there. And it was interesting to meet student people that I didn't know that were his students, different stages in his career. And of course, the stories they tell are quite different. For example, someone mentioned an incident where he fell on the ground and hit his head. And immediately, the doctors rushed in to try and help him. And as soon as he gained consciousness, made the statement that he hopes that nothing was damaged in his head, because that's pretty much the only organ that he still has functioning. And that shows you how honest he was in his interactions. But nevertheless, very optimistic, very positive about life. That came through. The other thing I wanted to mention is that there will be a paper, I believe, in Nature. I was asked about it by a reporter, and I saw it, about the black holes near the center of the Milky Way. So that the embargo will be lifted tomorrow, I guess. But nobody would see this video until then, so it's okay. There is evidence for a concentration, a population of stellar mass black holes concentrated near Sagittarius A star. So previously we haven't had such evidence. It comes from an overabundance of low mass extra binaries near the galactic center. And that's interesting, because the theorists predicted that there should be about 10,000 black holes in the inner parsec, in the inner few light years, around Sagittarius A star. And this might be the very first evidence that they exist out there, 10,000. But they just based their detection on of all the 10 systems that are concentrated in the region, in X-rays. So now for the presentations of today.
Okay, everyone, our
Our first speaker is Jean Ren. She's a physics postdoc at UToronto, and she's speaking about astrophysical deception, fake news, so it's not quite quite
thank you for the interesting introduction. Thank you very much for the invitation. And today I'm happy to talk about my recent work related to the horizonless ultra compact object and this gravitational wave ICOS, maybe you have heard about, which are based on the collaboration with Professor Bob Holdum and also another PhD student in ELT. So now LIGO Vogel collaboration have detected the gravitational wave signal from multiple compact binary coalescence. And now the observation from the Inspiral merger and the ring dump show a nice agreement with the prediction from general relativity for the binary black hole module. However, this might not be enough to confirm the existence of event horizon for this astrophysical black hole candidate. We can imagine if this candidate are actually horizonless ultra-compact objects, which have space-time resemble that of black hole closely from the weak gravity region all the way down to somewhere close to the horizon, then it will be hard to tell them apart. So for the electromagnetic radiation that has short wavelengths compared to the size of the object, they roughly follow the geodesic motion. So in the high redshift region close to the horizon, the outgoing particle can only escape within a small cone around the radial direction. So this means that the internal collision are very likely to produce particles outside of this escape cone. So a large trapped phase space will be populated. So this type of object could just have very small luminosity as long as the deviation from the black hole is close enough to the horizon. And for the gravitational wave, which has wavelengths comparable to the size of object, the motion is normally governed by such a field equation of the tortoise coordinate. And the information of the background spacetime is encoded in this effective potential. And for the black hole spacetime, the potential is characterized by a barrier, which is at the circular photon orbit, which is about at order m outside of the horizon. And it has been known and also highlighted recently that the dominant ring down mode that LIGO has currently observed is directly associated with this potential barrier instead of the ingoing boundary condition at the horizon. So the current observation can only verify the space-time down to the light ring place, but any correction close to the horizon would only appear after some time. Of course, we need theoretical motivation to think about this horizonless ultra-compact object. We know that black hole with the horizon can have Hawking radiation and then give rise to this information loss paradox. And to resolve this puzzle, drastic modification of the standout picture are expected close to the horizon of the macroscopic black hole. And one extreme possibility is that maybe the event horizon has actually never been formed, and there has already been some candidate along this line. So one example is a possible proposal in string theory. They claim the classical black hole spacetime is actually just an approximation of the quantum possible state, and the approximation will stop to apply somewhere outside of the horizon. And another example called the Grover star, which has the theta interior, which they claim comes from some quantum phase transition, and it then has some surface just right outside of the would-be horizon. So among all these different candidates, what's more interesting is the plausible fundamental connection of this object with the quantum gravity effect, like this possible proposal. But in view of the field theory, such a connection seems quite puzzling because the quantum gravity scale, the Planck, that Planck is actually much higher away from the curvature scale at the horizon of the macroscopic black hole. So the crucial question here is how quantum gravity effect could become important at the horizon scale. So in the first part of the talk, I will show you a concrete example to show that the Planck scale dynamics can indeed just naturally remove the horizon and give rise to this ultra-compact object. And on the observational side, if any of these objects is really formed by the binary merger, we need new observation to confirm their existence. Because there's no horizon, the initial incoming gravitational wave would get a chance to be reflected back after some time delay. And some will then transmit it out through aerial, and some will be reflected back in.
Question. Yes. So you're talking about gravitational waves, but in principle,
yes,
electromagnetic waves cannot probe this reflection.
So I explained a little bit earlier that the electromagnetic wave is behaves more like a particle. So in that sense, if you have this object which is close enough to the black hole, then you would have a very great gravitational potential, say like in the interior. Then those potential would have this very efficient trapping for the electromagnetic radiation, which has short wavelengths. But the gravitational wave normally has wavelengths comparable to the size of objects. So those things, they can have this tunneling effect happening. Right, so this is, of course, the problem is that currently we don't really have an object which you can do the numerical simulation to see what exactly the electromagnetic radiation could be. So then we just rely on this kind of argument that at least the ICOS seem to be something that could be reflected down.
What would excite an electromagnetic wave in a black hole merger anyway?
Not a black hole merger, but you can have gas falling into a black hole in a different environment. That's what Ramesh studies. And the question is, would there be any signature of this
boundary? Wouldn't that be obscured by the emission from the accretion disk?
No, because most of the energy is near the horizon. So
okay,
if there is no horizon, there could be energy leaking from the interior.
Yeah,
and
like
the question is,
this object could have some interior. Now there could be things coming out. But the argument is that those interior is actually a great gravitational potential. Those things get trapped. And I guess you need really some dynamical calculation to see just how much will get released. Right, so, but for the gravitational wave, then you would have this potential barrier which play a role to bounce things back and forth inside this region. And so this, for the outside observer, this will then just generate a chain of ICOS, which after the original black hole ring down that we have observed. There has already been some initial search of these ICOS in the public LIGO data by using the traditional mass filtering method, and I will talk about that analysis later in more detail. But the key point here is that the ICO template construction, in comparison to the well-known source, it actually has very large uncertainties. So to move forward, we actually need some new methods can more efficiently to search for this type of signal without knowing like all the details. So in the second part of the talk, I will just introduce our new windowing method as a way to deal with the model dependence in some extent. And we have looked at the LIGO public data with this method, and we have found some tentative ICO signals for multiple LIGO events. So let's start with an example of the horizonless ultra-compact object. So here, I need to modify gravity, and the theory we are working with is to add all quadratic curvature term on top of the Einstein field action, and here, this new dimension is coupling of order one. So such an action is normally just treated as a truncation of the effective field theory, so it would have problem by throwing away all higher-order term when you want to describe solution with very large curvature. But here we have a new perspective. We're trying to look at this theory as a classical approximation to a quantum theory. So we have an early paper to study this quantum theory in detail, and here this is the time. I will not get into the detail. But the basic picture is like the following. So as people have been knowing from 1970s, this pure quadratic action is actually perturbatively renormalizable as a quantum field theory, and all this new dimensions coupling are also asymptotically free, so this theory can be just defined at arbitrarily high energy. So after low enough energy, this theory would enter into a strong phase. And by making analogy with the more well-known quantum power dynamics, we have found the non-perturbative effect could efficiently remove the extra degree of freedom from this high order term, and in such a way that only the massless graviton is left at low energy. So if we identify the Planck mass as a strong gravitational scale, the general relativity will just emerge as an effective description for the graviton at low energy. So if this picture has any chance to be true, then the strong quantum effect is only important in a narrow region around the Planck scale, and we can use this classical quadratic action to as an approximation to describe solution which has a region with very small and large curvature. So with this in mind, my the question, yes?
Why are you only writing down just a few quadratic terms? Why aren't there a bunch more?
Yeah. So I'm saying because I'm not looking at the effective field theory. I'm looking at this quantum quadratic gravity, because the pure quadratic action by itself is perturbatively renormalizable, which means when you calculate quantum compression, no high order term are generated.
So you're ignoring the, you're not writing down the other terms because
yeah,
they're renormalizable.
So I'm just saying, I propose this is a theory to describe gravity. So that's just no other term from the beginning, and they will not be generated by this action as well. Yeah.
Okay.
Right, so this is a reason that you don't have to worry about the high order term. So now the question is simplified to finding the non-trivial solution in this classical quadratic theory with some dense matter source. So we have found when the matter distribution are less compact, then we find this star-like solution, which is regular everywhere. And with increasing compactness, until the distribution shrink within the Wolfe horizon, like in GR, the regular solution no longer exists. But what's interesting is the existence of a new family of horizonless solution for all the high compactness case. And we call this solution the 2-2 hole because it's associated with a new family of zero expansion around the origin. And if you look at the number of free parameters in this expansion, you can see this is the most generic solution in this theory. So it's likely to just describe the end point of the gravitational collapse in this theory. Yeah.
The curvature doesn't do anything special at the horizon.
Yeah, exactly.
So why does this theory
right.
care?
Yeah, exactly. This is a little puzzling. So now I want to show you
please,
what the solution is like. So this shows the metric, the TTGRR component, the function of the radius for this new solution. So as you can see, when you're outside of the horizon, then it's just a closely resembled Schwarzschild solution. And actually, there are some exponentially small correction, but you just cannot see. And it's true, when you have very large objects, the curvature here will be very small. Yeah, but what's interesting that the drastic deviation just occurred about Planck distance outside of the would-be horizon. And at the same time, the curvature also drastically grow large at this radio. So this behavior, like as you mentioned, like we don't expect from the beginning, but we found like we find this kind of behavior when we solve it numerically, and we find it's just like how close this deviation occur is just automatically controlled by the field equation, and also it's applied for all very massive objects. So I think if you ask the reason why this happened, it's more like because in this theory you have additional degree of freedom, so you have new family of solution. It's just somehow that new family solution gets become dominant, like at this place. So it then gives you some counterintuitive results. And within the would-be horizon, the metric quickly approaches that 2-2-0 expansion without changing the psi. So when you have very massive object, this region would have very large gravitational redshift and a very small radial size. It's actually only of the order of the Planck proper length. And also the region, the curvature in this region become super Planckian very quickly. And at the origin, it has a time-like curvature singularity. So such next singularity would have problem for the geodesic motion. But we find the singularity could be mild in the sense that it could appear regular when you probe the singularity by some finite energy wave package. So this also means the propagation of that wave packet, it can be automatically determined with a unique boundary condition at the origin. And in particular, this boundary condition is of the reflecting type. So this means the two-two hole shows an interesting example of such a horizonless ultra-compact object. And with that reflecting boundary condition at the origin, it would predict this gravitational wave echoes. And the primary feature of echoes are the roughly constant time spacing between different poles. And this actually provides a near observable to measure this near horizon quantum gravity effect. For the two-two hole, this time is mainly from the exterior. So it has this log dependence on the very large ratio between the astrophysical mass and the Planck scale. So when you have, say, like 30 solar mass object, this time delay is just in the order of 0.1 seconds. So this is longer than the damping time of the dominant black hole ring down, but it's also well within the stable data that people have collected. So this means ICO could very likely provide the smoking gun for this near horizon small distance correction. So now I will move to the discussion of the ICO search in a more model independent context. So in last year, a group from Parameter Institute started to look for ICOs in the public LIGO data. They're using the traditional match filtering method with a very crude toy model template for the ICO, and here they fix the time delay to be the Planck distance deviation outside of the would-be horizon. And they claim to see some tentative signal for ICOs with a p-value from the background noise to be around 1% after combining different events. And later, there's one LIGO team. They re-examine the analysis and point to some shortcoming in the method, like related to the prior range and the background estimation. And by analyzing the same data, they find a lower significance. So the LIGO team didn't go beyond the original method, but to move forward, the problem is to deal with the model dependence of this template method, because as we know, the match filtering method is normally applied to the well-known source, such as the binary black hole merger. But for ICOs, the precise waveform actually suffers a huge theoretical uncertainty. For example, since the ICO is mainly occurred at the post-merger stage, they can be studied with the perturbation wave equation on the curved background for the final merged object. So it will then depend on this effective potential and also the boundary condition. And this figure shows you the effective potential for different kind of ultra-compact object. The black curve is just the simplest toy model, a truncated black hole with some wall inside. And the blue curve is for the ultra-compact star, which has a potential blowing up at the origin. And this red curve is for the two-two hole that I just introduced. So you can imagine, given the variety of the ultra-compact object, by correlating data with one specific template, it's not a very efficient way to search for ICOs. But on the other hand, we can think about this ultra-compact object as cavities, which has a boundary in a boundary, reflecting in a boundary on the left, and a potential barrier on the right. And ICOs just correspond to the inertial trapped wave gradually leak out through the potential barrier. And the current LIGO observation already of a clear black hole ring down already constrain the shape of the potential barrier and also require the cavity, put a lower bound on the size of the cavity. So our new method is trying to, our goal is trying to develop new methods to extract the time delay of ICOs as a way to measure the primary feature of the cavity, its size, while being less sensitive to this more model-dependent variation, like the potential shape close to the inner boundary. So for this purpose, we have to look for ICO properties of we have to look for ICO properties for different objects. So we do this in by the analysis in the frequency domain. And we know the response of the wave equation to certain source can be found with the Green function. And in particular, the crucial information of the background spacetime is encoded in this Wronskian. So we define a transfer function at the inverse of the Wronskian. When you are away from the source, the observation is just a product of the transfer function at the frequency content of the source. And this figure shows you the absolute value of the transfer function for the truncated black hole and for different boundary conditions. And here are the results for the ultra-compact star and the 2G hole. So we can see that the transfer function is actually universally characterized by evenly spaced resonance pattern with gradually increasing waves. And this pattern stretch up all the way to the black hole ring down frequency. And for different case, you can see they differ mainly by an overall shift of the pattern and also the modification of the lowest frequency resonance spacing. And going back to the time domain, when you include more and more late time echoes, this pattern will be reconstructed gradually from high to low frequency. And at any given resolution, the pattern actually peaks at some intermediate frequency. So our search target is then set as to just by such a resonance pattern within some intermediate frequency bandpass close to the black hole ring down frequency. And here we remove this low and high frequency region can help to further reduce the model dependence on both the source and the ultra-compact object. So next, we need to develop some methods to efficiently reduce the noise according to this general echo properties. Here we propose to multiply some quasi-periodic window function onto the data to do the job. Like firstly, like in the first method, we use some time window to narrow the data between the time series of echoes, like this red dot. And with proper choice of the window parameters, the noise can get sufficiently reduced, and you can see the emergence of this signal pattern, resonance pattern, out from the noise. And if we impose that frequency bandpass, this can further suppress this spike-like artifacts, window artifacts, from the pure noise. And in the second method, we could just Fourier transform the data and directly impose the frequency window, like to zero the data between the resonance spike. And for this method, we need very high resolution with a relatively large number of echoes, trying to resolve this very narrow low frequency resonance. And with this, we can just use very narrow window on this part to enhance the signal to noise ratio. So for both methods, the window is just mainly described by the time delay, and there are a bunch of other few parameters could be used to optimize the search. And we also need to further use the correlation of the detector to reduce the noise. Basically, we impose the same window to the white and the string data after merger from two detector, and then we find the amplitude for the window data as a function of the time delay that we're interested in and other parameters. Here we developed three methods depending on which window to use, and then we just maximize the correlation of the two amplitude with respect to the window offset, and finally we will get some we will identify the signal peak of the correlation as a function of the time delay, and by averaging over other parameters that we're not interested in. So we found tentative signals for multiple LIGO events, and this shows two examples. And on the left panel, this red curve shows the signal peak for the average correlation as a function of the time delay. And for comparison, this blue line corresponds to doing a similar search to the data before merger while we don't expect echoes. And to estimate the significance of this signal peak, we we compute the p-value from the background noise by applying the same procedure to the LIGO data that's away from the potential echo signal. On the right panel, you can see from the black curve the fraction of finding a higher peak from such a background search. And for both cases, the p-value are smaller than 1%. So so with that straight method, we have found the 7 tentative signals for 5 LIGO events, including the latest neutron star merger events. And interestingly, for all this tentative signal, the best fit time delay in the unit of the final object mass are actually consistent with each other given the uncertainty of the mass. And they are also consistent with that 2-2-hole prediction that I showed before, so which is just a model for the quantum for the Planck scale deviation outside of the would-be horizon. Here we just give this inertial p-value estimation. For all signals, it is about or below 1%. And in our background search, some window parameter has been fixed by the signal search. So this would introduce some look elsewhere effect. So, and this is related to some clear prior range for the window parameter and deserve our further study. So in summary, I first give you an example of this ultra-compact object to show that the Planck scale dynamics can indeed naturally occur at this very large black hole horizon region and then give rise to this type of object. So I think at least this could show you that it's not extremely crazy to think about this type of object related to our real world and then look for their consequence. And if they are really formed by the merger, then the I-code could likely to provide the striking confirmation. But given our ignorance on what exactly the ultra-compact object could be, we think it will be good to use methods like the windowing method to extract the generic features of I-codes out of the noise. And by using these methods, we do find some interesting tentative signals for multiple LIGO events. There are a lot of open questions along both lines, so I'm happy to talk about more on this later if any of you are interested in. So I think I will just end by saying that at this moment, it's probably hard to say whether we have an echo or not, but I think it should be clear that more data from gravitational wave window do provide a great opportunity to probe new physics beyond standard model and general relativity. So thank you.
Are there any questions for the speaker?
I'm trying to gauge whether 1% is probably that we should be impressed by or not, because the question is how many trials do you have? And if you have more than 100, then one of them would show 1%.
Yeah, yeah.
So can you elaborate on why it's significant statistically?
So like for these two cases, we have the trials, like, so it's like we didn't have enough trials, so we don't even number this point.
Right, but the question is, you could search for many different things, right, in principle, in data.
You mean something other than the echoes and what?
So the question is how unusual is this, or whether the noise, which is probably not Gaussian.
But actually, this is a question I would like to ask the expert. So this is the results we find, but we don't really know like how significant or how impressive this is.
Just a suggestion, for example, we release entire O1 data,
uh-huh.
And it would be interesting you just try this method and just see how often you see random things to construct the entire false alarm grade for the things.
I want to say one thing. So here we do this, like we have this crowds because we're using that 1 hour data, roughly 1 hour data.
That's around the same.
Right. But actually we do worry that is there some non-stationary thing you may worry about, right? Because in principle, you should estimate p-value with the background at the time that the things don't occur, right? But if you're like looking at some data that's very far away, then do worry that you might, like, that background is not really something you're interested in.
That too, but would typically, and it is true that our detector might not be stable after 1 week or something. So our typical analysis of time windows actually about 1 week.
So it's in 1 week,
at least 24 hours is possible. Like that will buy you a lot of trial factors.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So like the day, say like 1 day, several days.
For example, that would be worth trying.
Okay.
Too.
I didn't follow all of your methods, the windowing methods.
Yeah.
But if you just simply took the signal and did an autocorrelation,
mm-hmm.
do you find a peak at the delay that you're talking about, 0.2 seconds or whatever?
So I think, no, if there's no windowing, if we just very naively...
if you just do a naive autocorrelation,
yeah.
you don't see.
Yeah.
So you need to do all these clever tricks.
Yeah, kind of, because we use this to suppress the noise.
I see, okay. Because that's, I think, really where Avi is coming from.
Right.
If you have to do many different tricks,
how many
tricks did you try, you know?
you
is
may,
that to be counted in the trials?
Yeah.
So it becomes...
Right, but that's what you want to do. You want to make a probability of false detection, right?
Yeah.
So you want to run it on
a lot of
data where you know there's no... You don't see anything. And then you want to see how many times you get a false positive.
Especially since it's not Gaussian, probably the noise.
Yeah.
So talking about number of sigmas is not really relevant. You want to ask the frequentist
But
question.
I think
like
our paper does talk about sigma somehow.
The other paper talks about sigma, 4.2. Yeah.
But it seems interesting that you say that the delta T is related to the mass. Right? Delta T.
Yeah, you have some log dependence. But that's based on a model. That model is basically saying that you have those modifications just at about some distance.
No, I'm talking about the data.
Okay.
You've got number of objects.
Oh, you mean the final radar?
Yeah. They all have different delta Ts, but they also have different masses.
Right.
And so what? You're finding that the delta T
by this ratio,
Td over m is kind of a constant?
It's consistent in that because this mass has some range. Like from LIGO paper, they can fit this mass within some range. So taking that one single range, we're finding all this range are kind of overlap. They overlap.
Well, but the neutron star case is a factor of 10 smaller than the black hole case.
Yeah, I think there are some complications of neutron star because I think the LIGO actually haven't found the post-merger signal, gravitational wave signal, for neutron star merger. So when I'm saying consistent, I'm really talking about the black hole case. And then, in principle, if you give me some model, like for the time delay as a function of the mass and the spin, then I can use this time to find what's the implication for the mass and spin for this remnants.
So are you saying that even for our lowest mass BBH and highest mass BBH, that your delta T can fit for all the entire mass range because our mass uncertainty is so big?
Because
you need to take some mass to search for
signal. Yeah, so we're just using your, say, like one sigma range of the mass on your paper, I guess.
And that fit for a wide range of delta T you found?
Yeah, so this is the range we find. Yeah, so I think it's just that given that mass range you give, then all this ratio, which is now a range, right? And now all this range are, they do have the overlap.
So it's consistent. She's saying that the numbers here is consistent with proportion, being proportional.
Simple
right.
Direct proportionality.
Yeah.
What is your interpretation of these echoes for the neutron stars? Because there you have no model.
Right. Exactly. So for the neutron star, I think there are several possibilities for the final outcome. But I think now maybe the one people favor is that the formation of a hypermassive neutron star, and then which will then decay into a black hole. And that lifetime could be something like in the order of 10 microseconds, something like that.
It could also be long. There was a paper on the
I think it could be longer. But so just we just keep this in mind and then like choose a chunk of data kind of just after the module and then just analyze whether you can see this signal peak for the echoes. And then we can move that chunk of data and then they somehow give you some information about the, if this echo arose, then this would have some implication about the formation time of the final.
The other day, Paul and I was discussing saying that the EM signature for the neutron star actually suggests a prompt a short, relatively short time scale for the collapse. So as someone wonder like if that will help you or you plan to put that into your analysis.
Yeah, so at this moment, as I mentioned, we have three methods. So some methods are sensitive to the starting point of the echo, but some are not. And now because we are not sure about like when it's formed, so we're using the method that's not very sensitive to this. But if you do have some like very good model for this input, we could try to use the method that's very sensitive to this starting time to do the search and see whether that could give more evidence.
Okay, so in the interest of time, some excellent questions, but we should move on. Well, thank you, speaker.